Welcome to Advanced Company Law. It's really great you decided to take up this course, and I'm very sure we'll be able to learn the entire Advanced Company Law by end of this entire course. So now, first let us try to understand, why is this company law even there in CS Professional? What is ICSI expecting from you? How should you prepare? And what are the easiest ways to do well in Advanced Company Law? So the first thing you should understand is, in our ICSI textbook, the first page, there is something called as level of knowledge that we easily forget and we never see that page. So please try to understand, the level of knowledge expected from you is that of an expert. As though a fully qualified company secretary is writing the exam, that is what they're expecting, and you have to know company law in that level of knowledge. The second and most important thing is, what is ICSI expecting? What are they expecting is very, very, very simple. If you keep these two points in mind, your entire company law will become easy for you. In fact, whatever you study in company law, these two things should be back of your mind, because they are trying to test you over here. In CS Executive, you already had company law. Again, you are having advanced company law in CS Finance. So what is the difference? Many students tell both are very similar, but the main difference is the practical and the procedural aspects. They are trying to test in every concept only how the concept can be applied practically. What is the procedural steps for that particular concept? So you can summarize the entire company law in just these two points. So whatever you study, please remember that they are trying to test the practical and the procedural aspects. And the next thing is, in whatever we study, we should know the secretarial documents. Very often students don't even touch the last portion, which is the annexures of each chapter. But that is the only scoring portion of every chapter. Why you should know the annexures is because you already know, or ICSI is expecting that you know the basic company law because you have passed the CS Executive program. In the final program, why many students falter, why they cannot go ahead, is simply because they don't give importance to the annexures, which is the secretarial documents like our specimens, resolutions, notices, etc. So if you keep these four points in mind, your entire company law is going to be very easy. So without wasting much time, let us go to the first chapter. In this video, we will try to understand what is a resolution and parts of a resolution. This is very important because in our CS professional program, they are going to test in you how to draft resolutions. There are many questions in the question paper which is asking you to draft resolutions for different topics, different sections. There is a certain formula which I have devised for you to easily draft any kind of resolution. So just like how you have formula in maths or financial management or accounts, over here in company law, we can use this formula which we call as the resolution formula. So if you have not even studied that particular chapter, if you know this formula, you can write something in respect to that resolution and definitely you'll get some marks. So please keep this in mind each time you draft any resolution. So if you have these points in mind, it is very easy for you to draft any resolution in company law or any law for that matter. Now, the first important thing in any resolution is the type of resolution. When you write in your exam also, please write this first, type of resolution. No matter what is the question, if you know the question is related to resolution, don't even read the question. You can first write this and then you can go and read the question and then write. So in type of resolution, after you read the question, you will know whether it is special resolution, ordinary resolution or board resolution. And then the next thing is the meeting, the type of meeting. That means in which meeting are we passing the resolution. What are the kinds of meetings? Board meeting, annual general meeting, extraordinary general meeting, class meeting, that is the different class of shareholders, creditors meeting, debenture holders meeting, etc. It could even be committee meeting which the board has, things like that. So when you write like this, the person who is correcting your paper is very impressed because you are trying to depict your knowledge relating to the type of resolution and the type of meeting. Now, after you write this, you must draft the resolution. Resolution always starts with the word resolve that, but there is no condition that you have to start with that. It is just a practice. What is resolve that I will be sharing in another video, but now let us try to understand the different parts of the resolution. In any resolution, you must ensure that the first thing is which section of company law are we drafting the resolution related to. If you are appointing a director according to section so and so, so resolve that pursuant to section so and so we are appointing director, section 161 for example, for additional director. Then subsection, this again might not be in every section with every resolution which you pass, but if it is applicable, try to remember the subsection. Then the rule or the rules. For example, it could be the audit and auditor's rules, it could be the share capital and debenture rules, or the meetings of the director's rules. So under which rule are we passing the resolution? And then the purpose of the resolution, that means why are we passing the resolution and what is the requirement of resolution, should be there when you draft the resolution. Then reference to MOA and AOA. That sometimes what happens is you must write in pursuant to clause 37 of Articles of Association of Company, this resolution is being passed, etc. So if that is there, that is another very important point. Point number 6 is what is resolved, means what did you decide? First, you are writing the section, subsection, rule, etc. Then the purpose. After that, the core of the resolution is what is resolved. That is, for example, you want to appoint a director. Is it resolution passed to appoint him or not to appoint him? That particular action should be reflected in your resolution. Then point number 7 is who is the person responsible to execute that resolution. It could be now company has passed a resolution to buy land. Now to buy that land, who is the person who is responsible? That should be mentioned in the resolution. So it could be the directors or any other officer of the company. It can even be a third party to which the company is delegating the powers. Then follow-up action, that means what should be done to give effect to that resolution, should also be mentioned in the resolution. And of course, please don't forget the form to be filed. For example, you appoint director. In the resolution, you should write in the ending, resolve further that form number DIR-12 be filed to the ROC. Then who should file? By the company secretary, by the director, whoever, even that should be mentioned. And the last one, it is not part of a resolution, but in some cases you need explanatory statement under section 102. So this has to be in your mind. So if you know these 10 points, you can draft any resolution, any chapter of the advanced company law. No matter what question they ask, if you memorize these points and remember that, let them ask any point, even if you know half of it. If you know that you must mention all these points when you draft the resolution, it is very easy for you to score. In the next video, I will be telling you what is the meaning of the word resolve that and how it is going to help each time you start your resolution by these two words, resolve that. In your study material, you might have seen after every chapter, we have different resolutions and the templates for the resolutions. If you see every resolution, it starts with two words, resolve that. Everyone blindly just memorizes resolve that, but let us try to understand what is the meaning of this resolve that and why we use these two words starting off every resolution. What is resolve that? Resolve that basically means decided after. Decided after what? Different procedures. First thing is, for every resolution, there is a proposal. Let us take an example. We propose to appoint Manish as director of the company. So when we propose this, the proposal has to be seconded by any other person in the meeting. So I propose Manish to be appointed as director. Along with that, another director, co-director, let us say Arjun, is seconding that opinion. After it is seconded by, the next important thing is discussion. So first, one person will propose a resolution. It could be any resolution. Our example is appointing Manish as director. After the proposal is done, second step is it is seconded by somebody. That's, yes, I agree to the proposal to appoint Manish as director by another person, in our case, Arjun. The third step is discussion. Whoever is present there, all the directors or the shareholders, as the case may be, depending on what is the kind of resolution, they will discuss that matter. It means Should we appoint Manish? Is Manish qualified to be director? What is the use of us appointing Manish, etc.? After the discussion happens, there could be some dissent. So we have another director on the board, for example. His name is Anuj. He will tell, we don't want to appoint Manish. But he is having a dissenting opinion. Means he is not agreeing to the proposal or the second or any of the discussion which is done. So after the dissent, he can tell, please record my dissent. That means, please record in the minutes that I am not agreeing. Then, after that, the next step is voting. Once the proposal, seconding, discussion, there could be dissent, and then let us put the resolution to vote. Voting can be by poll or voting by show of hands. So depending on what is the kind of meeting, we can take a poll or show of hands as the case may be. After the voting is complete, obviously we will count the votes, that is common sense. And then the resolution is said to be adopted or the decision is adopted. That means the resolution is passed. So this is the meaning of resolved, that is decided after. And now whatever you have resolved, resolved is nothing but decision is taken. Whatever you have resolved and whatever you have decided, it could be related to two aspects. One is, it is final for that meeting. That means what resolution you passed, it is final. It need not have anybody else's authority. There is nobody else who has to give yes or no to that resolution. Or there could be a situation where that resolution does not have power. For example, we appoint an additional director, Manish. For that, it is subject to the approval of another meeting, which is shareholders meeting. It could be AGM or EGM, whatever. So any resolution can be either final for that meeting. That means the authority is there within the act that the resolution can be passed by that particular board or the committee or the shareholders. Or it is subject to approval of somebody else. Who is that somebody else? It could be, if board meeting means, it could be that somebody else's shareholders. Or if it is a shareholders meeting, that somebody else could be our ROC or any other regulatory authority, even their permission may be required. The resolution might not be final. So when we say that the resolution is decided after the different steps and the decision could be final or subject to another authority, the whole concept is nothing what we call as resolved that. So whenever you say resolved that, it involves all these processes. And that is the meaning of resolved that. And that is why we start every resolution with the word resolved that. But please remember, there is no condition that you must start with resolved that. You can even put it in simple words. It was decided that. But then for exam sake, don't take risk. You can just write resolved that, because that is a general practice.